Morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship as we gather in the name of our Lord and Savior. You may have noticed, I'm not going to make any specific announcements except to point you, we have a new format for our weekly highlights. And in this new format, you'll find all the information you need about upcoming events, individualized prayer lists, connecting with the church, the youth events, those things that are upcoming that are important to us as a congregation. One thing I will point out is the upcoming and ongoing pictorial directory, which is very important for us as a congregation to get to know each other, for me to get to know you. And you can do that by either having someone take your picture. Are there any of them today? Okay. If you wish, you can take your picture today right after church, or you can take a picture in your own setting and send it to the church office. If you need help with that, Susan will be happy to help you with that as well. So please get that done. I believe we have like a November deadline that we're working with to put this all together. So, new highlight format, so please be aware of that and what's going on here in church. We are here today to worship our Lord, so we stand to sing our opening.
Thank you.
Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Amen.
If you, O Lord, kept the record of sins, O Lord, who could stand? Spirit of God calls forth sacrifices pleasing to God. Brotherly love, hospitality to strangers, care for all in need, faithfulness in marriage and in family, fearless joy in the Lord, right faith and right worship. Let us ask God to forgive our sinful neglect of faith's power to have free course in our life.
Almighty God, we confess to you and confess to the Father who are in need. We have not loved you in our entirety. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. Alone in your name, without hope, health, or help. And have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen.
May the God of peace equip you with everything good that you may do His will. In the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Your eyes have seen, do not hasten to bring you to court. Or what will you do in the end when your neighbor puts you to shame? Argue your case with your neighbor yourself instead. And do not reveal another secret, lest he who hears you bring shame upon you and your ill repute have no end. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle is from Hebrews chapter 13. Let brotherly love continue. Do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for thereby some have entertained the angels unawares. Remember those who are in prison as though in prison with them, and those who are mistreated, since you are also in the body. Let marriage be held in honor among all, and let the marriage bed be undefiled, for God will judge the sexually immoral and adulterous. Keep your life free from love of money, and be content with what you have. For he has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So we can confidently say, the Lord is my helper, I will not fear. What can man do to me? Remember your leaders, those who spoke to you the word of God. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Do not be led away by diverse and strange teachings, for it is good for the heart to be strengthened by grace, not by foods which have not benefited those devoted to them. We have an altar from which those who serve the tent have no right to meet. For the bodies of these animals and whose blood is brought into the holy places by the high priest and sacrificed for sin are burned outside the camp. So Jesus also suffered outside the gate in order to sanctify the people through his own blood. Therefore, let us go to him outside the camp and bear the reproach he endured. For here we have no lasting city, but we seek the city that is to come. Through him, let us continually offer up a sacrifice of praise to God that is the fruit of lips and acknowledge his name. Do not neglect to do good things and to share what you have, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God. Obey your leaders and submit to them, for they are keeping watch over your souls as those who will have no to give an account. Let them do this with joy, not with groaning, for they would be of no advantage to you. This is the word of the Lord.
Friend, move up higher. Then you will be honored in the presence
humbles himself will be exalted. He said also to the man who had invited him, when you give a dinner or a banquet, do not invite your friends or your brothers or your relatives or rich neighbors, lest they also invite you in return and you be repaid. But when you give a feast, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed, because they cannot repay you. You will be repaid at the resurrection of the just. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Should ask you to move to a lower place when someone more distinguished than you shows up. This would be seen embarrassingly by the other guests, and you would be humiliated because you've been asked to step to a lower place. So like Jesus said, take the lower place. Because then when the one who invites you sees where you're sitting, he will say, what are you doing there? Come, take a more prominent place, and this too will be seen by others. And instead of humiliated, you will be exalted in their eyes. In certain situations, I think we're all pretty good at humility. We don't think of ourselves more highly than we ought, do we? Consider this example. You would never think of walking into a wedding hall and taking the seat at the head table. You wouldn't even take the seat that's reserved for the parents of the bride and groom. That would be a big social no-no. So does Jesus really need to be teaching us about public humiliation? After all, we're pretty good. Well, here's the challenge. We know we are not deserving of the head table. Conversely, we are just as certain we don't deserve to be at that last table either. The one that's way back, off in the corner, back in the shadows, right by the kitchen, where you can hear what the waiters and waitresses really think about you. It's that table reserved for the ones that neither the bride nor the groom really wanted to invite, but they did anyway. We don't deserve that table, because while we're not the best, we're not the worst. We do think about ourselves in an interesting way, because it all has to do, whether we admit it or not, we may be pretty good at some humility, but our favorite topic is still me. The me mentality that has a huge impact on all of life. Even in our daily speech patterns, I've noticed a new phrase that has come into our vernacular. You see it, I saw it in a restaurant. The waitress asking if you would like some more water or whatever. And instead of saying, no, thank you, the person says what? No. Come on. I'm good. I'm good has replaced no, thank you. That doesn't make sense. But that's what we've done. I'm good. It's a strange substitution, but very indicative of what we think of ourselves. We think we're good. Mastering the arts of exalting ourselves. In that classic, you've heard it a million times, comparison game that we all play. Like the wedding hall scenario, we judge ourselves in comparison to the lowest place that we can identify. I'm not at the head table. I know I don't deserve that, but I know I don't deserve to be with those losers. Same standard that we use in all aspects of life, especially in our relationship to God. I'm no loser, but I'm good. Not great, but I'm good. I know I'm at least better than. And then you fill in the blanks with who you think you're better than. We know we think about ourselves, but in honesty, we have to admit that we're biased. Maybe even genetically predisposed to stick up for ourselves, defend ourselves against the possibility of being anything less than good. There's another opinion, I think, that we need to consider. While we are twisting ourselves into knots, trying to pat ourselves on the back. Jesus comes in, and he comes in with words of clarity. He who exalts himself will be humbled. God's word completely contradicts all that we think about ourselves and our goodness. And to all of us who say to ourselves, and we will say to anyone else who will listen, that I'm good, the Lord responds with, yes, you think so, but remember, I'm God. What does the Psalm of the Reformation say? Psalm 46. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. We must see ourselves as the Lord sees us. As we try to exalt ourselves, we are confronted with God. God is love, 1 John 4. We love that. For God so loved. God is love. But remember your catechism days. Because God is love, yes, but God is righteous. God is just. He is holy. Meaning he cannot turn a blind eye to sin, our sin. And that's one of my favorite things that I see on Sundays from time to time, from my perspective, you could say, is that occasional reaction to something that is said. When I look out and I see somebody hitting an elbow, which means what? Hey, Mom. Hey, Dad. Pastor's talking about you. Well, guess what, Mom, Dad, son, daughter, pastor, world. The Lord is talking to you. He's talking to you to humble you. To humble you in the knowledge of your sin. The elbow is from the Lord, bringing us to that place of lowest position. Because in our sins, left to themselves, they deserve and reserve for us that lowest spot of all. That place of eternal torment. The place of complete separation, total darkness. Complete separation from God. But when we are low, the Lord lifts us up. In love, God is humbling us today in order that we would acknowledge our sin. Taking us down to that point where we must confess, Lord, I am not good. Not good. In the fullness of ourselves, we admit, no, we're empty. We're that empty plate, that empty glass, that empty life. Empty without the presence of God and his love lifting us up. Lifting us up in hope. In sin, I'm not good. Greatness is not a matter of where we sit. In fact, it's just the opposite. The greatest is not the one who sits, but the one who serves. And that's what Christ does. He comes not to be served, but to serve. To take on the lowest possible place. And that is sin. Christ became sin for us, so that in him we would have the righteousness of God, the blood of Christ poured out for the forgiveness of all who are sitting in that lowest spot. And that blood covers us in forgiveness. God lifting us up once again, filling us now with hope. And it is his desire that we would be filled. And we are filled with his grace. From that lowest position imaginable to the place of honesty. unimaginable prominence, and that is child of God. Children of the Heavenly Father who have by His grace alone a permanent place in His kingdom. So that in response now we say, Lord, I'm good because You have forgiven me. Filled with forgiveness, filled with His love, filled with His Spirit, I can now do good because of the good that has been done for me. May we live in true faith-filled response to the goodness of God. In the name of Jesus, our Savior, amen. Please stand. In the peace of God that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus to life everlasting. Amen. We join now together confessing our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of His Father. Remembering before You this day, Janice, Cindy, Roger, and Linda, for Peggy, Brenda, Bobby, Johnny, Stephen, and John, Hilda, Ron, Steve, and Lois, Fred, David, Julie, Adrian, Renee, for Eli, Carrie, and Craig, John, AC, Wayne, Benny, and Lisa, for those, Lord, whom we name silently in our hearts. Give to them, Lord, that which is in Your best will for their lives. Lord, in Your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Grant Your Holy Spirit, Lord,
to all those who share the wedding feast of Christ your Son, that we would receive his body and blood from this altar, that we would eat and drink in true repentance and firm faith, and to our abundant blessing. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Merciful God, you call on us to practice brotherly love, to show hospitality to strangers, and to remember all those who are in need. We come to you confident that you will not leave us nor forsake us, but will grant us all that we need for this body and life. Bestow on us the full riches of your grace in all of life's situations and circumstances. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers, Lord, brought before you, in the name and for the sake of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, by his glorious resurrection, opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers. Deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." And in the same way also he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
Thank you that for his sake you have given us hearts and peace in this sacrament. We ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.